This is Billy Kay, welcoming you to Scotland's Black History, a series made in 2003 but updated with new material, such as Dr. Stephen Mullen of Glasgow University's research into runaway slaves.
One of the most famous examples is Jamie Montgomery, who runs away from Ayr, 1756. Jamie was a Virginian-born slave. He's sent to Ayr to learn a trade. Then he's to be taken back to the colonies. Because he has a trade, he would be more valuable. He gets dragged up to Port Glasgow. He's tied to a horse and dragged. We have a description of this in the legal papers, that Jamie is dragged through the marshes between Ayr and Port Glasgow. So he runs away, actually, in Port Glasgow and goes to Edinburgh, where he's eventually caught. This would have been the precursor to the Joseph Knight case, because the challenge was going to be against the notion of slavery in Scotland. Unfortunately, Jamie dies in the Tolbooth at Edinburgh. One in Glasgow, a young woman, Arona, is from Dalkeith. She runs away. She had a green dress on and a collar with her master's name. It would have been a slave collar, so this would have denoted ownership by the master and would have given his contact details. So this young woman would have been in Glasgow city centre. You know, I don't want to use the comparison with a dog collar, but I mean, this is the analogy that could be made, because the enslaved people would have been regarded as subhuman property in some cases.
Programme 3, The Virginia Slaves' Lament.
Some contemporary observers thought that the record of the Scot was not always creditable. For instance, Samuel Taylor Coleridge observed in 1812, and I quote, "Of the overseers of the slave plantations in the West Indies, three out of four are Scotsmen, and the fourth is generally observed to be very suspicious in his cheekbones. And on the American continent, the whippers in, or nigger bishops, as they are called, are either Scotchmen or, in brackets, monstrosius, the Americanized descendants of Scotsmen."
I'm sitting high above the huge expanse of the Potomac River in Washington, D.C. This is the area of Virginia where West of Scotland merchants had such a hold in the colonial tobacco trade that the Americans regarded them as foreign capitalist exploiters. They cared not a jot for American attitudes, nor for the fact that their tobacco wealth was created on slave labour. As one of them wrote home, "There is a world here for the winning." Their legacy is tangible here in America and on the shores of the Clyde.
There were several families in Glasgow who had connections with the tobacco trade over in Maryland and Virginia in America. William Cunningham, John Glassford, Alexander Spears. They had store systems out on the riverbanks in the Chesapeake area and would offer credit to the tobacco plantations. This would always ensure that they had to give their tobacco straight to the storekeepers, which would mean that when the ships went over from Glasgow to collect the tobacco, there would always be a ship full of tobacco ready to come straight back. In that way, they would always have a fast turnaround of the ships and therefore were more profitable. The money that they made from these tobacco journeys was obviously ploughed back into the economy of Glasgow, and many of these families built townhouses in the centre. One of these examples is William Stirling, who built a house which is now the Gallery of Modern Art. Also, John Glassford built a mansion which is at the top of Glassford Street. And obviously we see these connections in Glasgow today with the names of the streets, such as Virginia Street and Glassford Street, Jamaica Street, etc.
Lynn Morgan of the Mitchell Library and Professor Tom Devine of Aberdeen University on the west of Scotland's profitable liaison with British colonies, where crops of sugar, tobacco and cotton were harvested by African slaves. One of the very first petitions by the City of Glasgow to the United Kingdom Parliament after the Union demanded not the abolition of slavery, but the opening up of the slave trade to Scottish merchants. Thereafter, some had a go at slaving voyages, but the less than lucrative ventures of the good ships Loyalty and Hanover of Port Glasgow led the majority to concentrate on tobacco. However, many Scots slavers traded for decades out of Liverpool and Bristol, while in London, the conglomerate of Grant, Oswald and Company went a stage further, going to the very heart of darkness itself and developing a slave station on Bunce Island in the Sierra Leone River.
This factory or castle had been an old fort of the Royal African Company, but had been abandoned in 1728. They decide to do something very different from what had gone before. I mean, the norm in that part of the African coast was what historians have called a ship trade. And they decided that they could achieve greater gains by establishing something that they called a fort trade or a castle trade. And so rather than you being a slave trader and going from place to place to place, acquiring slaves and doing the bartering with the individual African chiefs, what you would end up doing is going directly to this transshipment point, this castle, and the company would serve as a middleman. It's their men who brought the enslaved Africans down from the interior, marked them with brands. You know, they provided a whole range of services for the slave traders.
Professor David Hancock of the University of Michigan, whose book Citizens of the World examines the worldwide trading empire of Grant Oswald and Company. They began in a small way, delivering slaves to their own and their neighbours' plantations, but within 20 years they were supplying thousands of slaves to French and British plantations all over the Caribbean and the American South. In its heyday, before the American Revolution, the staff on the island comprised 140 black Gramita freedmen and 35 whites, who originated in the partners' home counties of Caithness, Aberdeenshire and Ayrshire.
They come to depend very heavily on skilled white Scottish labour, and the whole range. You get Scottish surgeons, Scottish accountants. Scots were particularly good for this kind of work because the kind of work that they used was often clerical work, and the Scottish educational system was much better than the English educational system. So their experience was that if you brought a young boy down from Aberdeen, he could do the kind of accounting work and do the kind of negotiation work in a much more effective way and leave a much better written record than a young boy from Essex. And it comes to the point by 1775, they almost never hire anyone from England at all. It's almost exclusively a Scottish organization.
The fact that most Scots were literate gave them one advantage, but another was afforded by the extensive networking of Scots, looking out for their kinsmen in far-flung places. As Tom Devine illustrates in his book The Scottish Empire, the clan system appears to have staged a revival in the colonies. Alex Murdoch of Edinburgh University on another example from North Carolina's Cape Fear River.
It appears that there were links between Scots involved in the Jamaican sugar economy, and through those links, people from Scotland discovered that it was possible to take up land. But it did mean then, in that case, that you had people from the Scottish Highlands entering a slave economy in North Carolina, which was relatively small in scale. But for example, those families in particular, such as the McAllisters from Arran and Kintyre, who went and became a prominent family in the Cape Fear Valley of North Carolina, as they moved into production of tar and turpentine, which was a cash crop, that involved them in recruiting and maintaining a slave labor force.
The Cape Fear colonists were mainly from Kintyre and Skye. One of their descendants, Charles McNeill, became Poet Laureate of North Carolina, writing in English and Scots, while some churches had Gaelic services attended by the Highlander slaves. A few years ago, I interviewed Nathan McCormack in Scotland County. His views on slavery are not untypical of the Old South.
Slavery? Well, that story is about 90% far from the truth. What happened was that they'd bring these slaves over from Africa, and you know the condition that they was in then, mentally and everything else. And they had a place in the church for them to go to church on Sunday. They would feed them, they'd clothe them, and they'd work them. No question about that. But not too many of them was mistreated. Some, yeah, you're going to find some of anybody's mistreated, but they had a good deal there. Some of those people in South Africa today, if they were slaves, it'd be better off. I remember some slaves. I can show you a spot We used to call them Uncle and Aunt. And Uncle Eli Ross, he lived on this farm, and he was as black as that. And his hair was as white as cotton, and his eyes was white. God, he must have been well over 100 years old. I can remember about 7 former slaves. One was Uncle Carlisle Alford. He was born on the McCormick land that about 2 miles from here. After slavery ended, they gave him a home. They gave him a tract of land for his garden. He would go up and feed the mules and the cows. He'd work the garden. And even when he got old, he needed a doctor, McCormick's pay for it. They had a pretty good deal. And a lot of these people, they gave him a 50 acres of land, just gave it to him.
Did the slaves always take the Scottish name, the name of the owner?
Yeah. Now, Hasty, H-A-S-T-Y, is a Scottish name. They had this one slave, Uncle Joe Hasty. I remember him. I was 17 years old when he died. And they bought him for 40 cents a pound. And he's a little Negro. Probably wouldn't weigh more than 90 pounds. And they gave him 40 acres of land. He lived on it all of his life. He took the name Hasty. Normally, they would take the name of the master.
And most African Americans retain the names they received on the plantations. Many, of course, have Scottish blood. Ian White recalls a church gathering on Iona.
In the course of this, my wife noticed a very large black man with a Monroe tartan kilt on. So after the opening ceremony, we were milling around. She went over and introduced herself and said, I'm very interested, you've got a Monroe tartan kilt, because my mother was a Monroe and came from Northeast. And he said, sure, he's an American. He said, I'm a Monroe and I'm going to see my ancestors in, you know, up in the Northeast. And my wife suddenly realised, with a kind of sickening reality, that her forebears had been cleared, gone over to the southern states and made slaves of his ancestors.
Mr. Monroe was not the first black man to wear the tartan. When a Swedish botanist called Henry Smithman visited Banks Island, he gave us an astonishing snapshot of life in the Scottish Empire.
You have to imagine what this island is. It's a small, barren rock with a medieval castle arising up out of the heat of the surrounding swamps. They would hear the cries of the monkeys. They would sort of see this overgrown terrain. And he describes a game of golf. This is not golf in the way we think of it with 9 holes or 18 holes. This was a small island, and so they had constructed a golf course of 2 holes, not too far apart. And it's a game that's being played by Scottish men and Scottish boys. And they basically go from one hole to the next and back to the other hole and back to the next. And in this game of golf, he describes what these people wear. And this is what caught my eye. The Scots men and the Scots boys are sort of draped in white cotton, which had come from India. He describes the slaves, who are in fact acting as caddies, and they're dressed in tartan loincloths. These were cloths that had been shipped down, as best as I can figure, from Glasgow or Kilmarnock.
Black caddies with tartan loincloths. You couldn't make it up. It sounds like a tale from romantic fiction. And that was another Scottish import into the Deep South. Mark Twain blamed the novels of Sir Walter Scott for the delusions of nobility which led to a civil war defending slavery, and in its aftermath, the creation of a white supremacist KKK, Ku Klux Klan. Certainly, Scott's influence is everywhere in the names of the slaveholding plantations. Donald MacDonald and George Rogers of the University of South Carolina.
Here we have Annandale, which still is a plantation with that name. Bannockburn, Caledonia, Lower Waverley, Waverley, Ross Dhu.
There were a number of Civil War songs that had Scottish connections, like the Bonnie Blue Flag, which was about the original flag of the Confederacy, and that was an old reel tune. There was one called Riding a Raid. Now, I have the words to it. It was to the tune of Bonnie Dundee, and it goes like this. 'Tis old Stonewall the rebel that leans on his sword, and while we are mounting, prays low to the Lord. Now each cavalier that loves honor and right, let him follow the feather of Stuart tonight. Come tighten your girth and slacken your rein. Come buckle your blanket and holster again. Try the click of your trigger and balance your blade, for he must ride sure that goes riding arrayed. And that was about Jeb Stuart and Stonewall Jackson. Jeb Stuart obviously wore a white cockade in his hat.
Now gallop, now gallop, to swim or to ford. Old Stonewall still watching, praise love to the Lord. Goodbye, dear old rebel, the river's not wide, and Maryland's lights in her window to guide. Come tighten your girth and slacken your rein. Come buckle your blanket and holster again. Try the click of your trigger and balance your blade, for he must ride sure that goes riding the raid. Sabers and not a dull blade. Come tighten your girth and slacken your rein. Come buckle your blanket and holster again. Try the click of your trigger and balance your blade, for he must ride sure that goes riding the rein.
Another Scottish connection was that rather very disreputable clan, the Ku Klux Klan, which were used, of course, during Reconstruction after the Civil War. But they used the fiery cross, and they profaned an old Highland symbol, which, of course, was quite different in the days of the clans, because the clans were summoned to warfare by the fiery cross. We knew about that. We learned about that as children from reading Sir Walter Scott.
There's the concern in the South, and you start talking about clans and burning crosses. And as you know, at the Grandfather Mountain Highland Games, they burn a cross, which is also what the KKK did. Now, there's no connection officially in the games and, of course, the KKK. But in the image of a lot of people who aren't tied to the Scottish games, this is a concern. And in fact, in the 1915 film, The Birth of a Nation, which was made by Arthur Griffith, who is recording the history of the KKK, he says that they got the idea of the burning cross from the hills of Scotland, from the unconquered race of the Scottish, which of course they were conquered, but this is where he draws it from.
Celeste Ray. Ironically, the same Walter Scott phenomenon had an effect on one of the greatest leaders on the other side of the debate, as I discovered when I joined David Govier on the Glasgow Black History Tour.
This is the Ramshorn Kirk just here, and across the road you see the City Halls on candle rigs. And the City Halls was an important place for meetings in the 19th century. This was the height of the abolitionist movement from the 1830s to the 1870s, which was fighting for abolition in the United States. And in 1860, a very famous man, Frederick Douglass, who was a runaway slave from the American South, he came and delivered a lecture on the unconstitutionality of slavery. That was his point, and he made it very strongly here in Glasgow. Douglas took his name from Walter Scott's novel Castle Dangerous. There was a family in that novel known as the Black Douglases. His mother's slave name was Bailey. He took the name Douglas, a highly ironic name, of course. And this was a very significant move because, of course, slaves were in those days given their master's names. He chose a Scots name, one from Walter Scott, who was a very influential man in the ideas of the time.
Now the burden I must bear, while the cruel scourge I fear, in the land of Virginia, Virginia. And I think on friends most dear, with a bitter, bitter tear. And alas, I am weary, weary, oh.
Robert Burns's Virginia Slave's Lament, inspired by seeing the horror of a packed slave vessel off Dundee. There were slaving voyages out of Montrose further up the coast at this time. For most Scots, though, slavery remained out of sight, out of mind. Even the owners of Bunce Island managed to omit guilt from their conscience.
The recognition that what they were doing was inhumane is very hard to tease out, and these particular partners had an awareness of what was happening. The two Boyds owned plantations in St. Kitts and Nevis. Richard Oswald owned plantations in Virginia and Jamaica. Sir Alexander Grant owned a handful of plantations in Jamaica. Grant, Oswald, and the Boyds had spent time, and so they had witnessed the inhumanity of plantation life. And after they're back in London in 1748, they never go back to the Caribbean, so they have this disconnected, impersonal view. I've often thought of it almost the way bomber pilots flew over Germany in World War II. I mean, they are so far removed. And so you read their letters, and the thing that you're struck by is the lack of connection with real people. So Richard Oswald and Sir Alexander Grant write very specific requests to make sure that the slaves are branded only a certain way. Now, they're still branded, but they are branded in only one place as opposed to all over their body, or that it is a less cruel form of branding. It's hard for us to get our head around a less cruel form of branding, but they thought there was.
In his Nobel Prize-winning novels, the Scottish-American writer William Faulkner explores the legacy of such warped morality on what he calls Scotch Mississippi, concluding that everyone, black and white, has been tainted and corrupted by the experience. In 18th century Scotland, morality was suspended in favour of the economy.
Many Scots, like Dundas, saw this as a moral issue that the empire couldn't afford to address.
In intellectual terms, the case against slavery has been pretty thoroughly made by people like Adam Smith and David Hume. The case for actually doing anything about it, about stopping it, doesn't really happen until the start of the 19th century, and it's driven then by evangelical religion.
Novelist James Robertson. And the religious debate in Scotland also affected the South when, after the disruption of 1832, the Free Church of Scotland received funding from Scots in the slave-owning states.
There was a debate in Scotland over whether the Free Church should take money from slave owners in the American South. Hand back the money was a slogan at the time.
Ian White, former chaplain at Edinburgh University, has studied the rise of the abolition movement in Scotland, which was graced by figures such as Burns's publisher William Creech and the Reverend Walker, who can be seen skating on Duddingston Loch in Raeburn's famous painting. But one of the greatest agitators in the whole of the empire was the orator Andrew Thompson.
The motion before 2,000 people in the assembly rooms, a huge meeting, was that slavery be abolished at the earliest possible opportunity. Thompson gets up and says, "I oppose that motion," and everybody's thoroughly shocked. What on earth is this? I thought he was on our side. He said, "I oppose it because it doesn't go far enough. Slavery must be abolished immediately." He has this marvellous phrase where he says it's the very upas tree that casts its pestiferous shade over everything that it comes in contact with, and the tree must be uprooted and hacked to pieces and burnt to the four winds of heaven. So it is with slavery. And he poses the question to the meeting, if slavery is sin, can we come out of sin by degrees? Can we decide when we can stop sinning against God? We have to stop now.
The slave trade in the British Empire ended in 1807, while the emancipation of the slaves came in 1833. The movement also fueled by prominent Scots such as Zachary Boyd, the Reverend James Ramsay and James Stephen. Their arguments won at home, but in the Scots communities in America, it would take another three decades for slavery to be defeated, and another century for attitudes to change. Ian White was in Mississippi during the desegregation troubles of the 1960s.
As a Scot, I was welcomed by a lot of people who wanted to tell me about the Scottish ancestry. I remember going to dinner with a judge, and this was the long, hot summer of 64. It was where three civil rights workers disappeared and were found under a dam, and I was in Meridian, Mississippi when they were looking for them. And I was having dinner with this judge who had met friends of my parents and was delighted to have this young Scot. We were dining alone, black servant. And he said to me, "I hope you're going to go back to Scotland and tell people it's not really as bad as it's made out to be." And the moment I failed to collude with that and started to tell him some of the things I'd seen, it was as if a metal sheet had come down in the middle of the table. It was cut off point. I've seen the same in South Africa, you know, because white South Africans so often were desperate to justify and say it's not really as it's said.
Now, the Scottishness of the identity of white Southerners is a lot more prominent than it was a few generations ago, something viewed quite differently from first a Northern, then a Southern perspective.
They have taken on a new identity. Now that racism is out, a lot of Southerners have hit on something to which blacks, by definition, can't belong. There's been all this fuss about state flags that have the Confederate battle flag in them, and the offense to blacks. But a kilt, a pipe band, Highland dancing, who could be offended by that? But you won't see any blacks there.
Some of the people that I would consider the most dyed-in-the-wool sort of Southern nationalist are also very dyed-in-the-wool Scots. And yeah, I think that there's probably an interest in tying Southern history into Scottish history, because Scottish history has all the characteristics of Southern culture that are heroic and grand without any of the sort of baggage, the politically incorrect baggage of slavery and the stigmas. So you can get all that is good in the South by identifying yourself with the Celtic tradition, whereas you don't get any of the bad stuff.
Donald Fraser and Professor Roland Berthoff. In the next programme, I'll be moving from the American South to East Africa and following in the footsteps of David Livingstone and the Scottish missionaries in Malawi. And, historically, there's a tangible connection. The Reverend Andrew Ross is the author of David Livingstone, Mission and Empire.
David Livingstone's oldest son, John, was in the Union Army. And, of course, he knew he had committed a crime by doing this because the British government had said it was a crime for any British citizen to join either the Union or the Confederate Army. But John was in the Union Army and was taken prisoner and died of wounds in one of the southern prison camps. Strangely enough, the Black Methodist Church built a college on the site of that old prison camp of Union soldiers and called it Livingston College, and it still is there today in North Carolina. But anyway, the boy died, and of course he was deeply moved by this, not just because his son was dead, but because he passionately believed in the cause and saw Lincoln as a great hero. And part of the reason why he wanted to develop cotton growing in Central Africa was to undermine slave cotton in America and help to bring down American slavery. He was very explicit on this, that this is one of the great ways to create free cotton fields in Africa and undermine the slave cotton in America.